What if I were to suggest that you play a key role in the awakening world? And that you are watching this because you have heard the call. We can start right now by opening our hearts and minds. Welcome to the awakening world.
Good evening, everybody. Happy day and night of love. I'm Love Coach Scott Katamas. So this is a big holiday in my reality, and I'm really grateful to be spending this evening with you. And we've brought together some of my favorite people, people that are dedicated to relationship and to love. And we're going to be talking tonight about how to create greater love in all of our lives, whether you're single or in relationship, or it's complicated. Most relationships are complicated. And also, not just love relationships with a romantic partner, but our family relationships, our friends, our workmates. Life is relationship. And we all want more love in our life. And we do that through our relationships. And that's what we're going to be exploring tonight. And we've got wonderful people with us. First and foremost, I'm really happy to have with me the co-founder of Love Coach Academy, Katrina Vaillancourt. She is one of my dearest friends and also the creator of the Love Smart Cards. So it's great to have her with us.
There you go.
And we also have, there they are. And we're going to hear all about those for sure. We also have with us Stephen Rowland, and he is the founder of RelationFlix. We've done several shows with RelationFlix and his partner Dolphin, but that is not Dolphin with him. That is beloved Nina, her first time here. So welcome, Nina, and it's great to have both of you with us tonight.
Thanks for having us, Scott.
We also are really happy to bring back Star Wolf. She's been on the show before, and she is a magnificent coach and tantric breath worker. I was actually coaching somebody who brought up, oh, I have this wonderful coach, and it was Star Wolf. So she definitely has really been a very significant person in our tribe. And I'm really delighted that Ariel Brown is back with us. Welcome back, Ariel. She is, what I love about Ariel is her honesty and vulnerability. I get hundreds of emails every day, I mean, literally. But when I get yours, Ariel, I really try and read them because they're always so honest and they always have insights from a very personal experience. So she's a really wonderful writer. And thank you for being with us tonight. I'm really glad you're here.
Total pleasure. Thank you for the invitation.
Absolutely. And of course, thank goodness, my bro, my co-pilot, he who really makes the Global Peace Tribe sing, who's got his Love Smart Cards out. There you go. And I love how you've created the pinkish, reddish Global Tribe. How'd you do that?
It's pure magic, Scott. Only I know how to do it.
All right. Well, it's beautiful. Good job.
It is not. I thought, what can I do for tonight without just having something too generic? And I thought, hey, here's something not too generic. I'll share the secrets with you later privately. But okay. Until then, let's have a little. This is called Love Will Lead Us. And what a concept, right? Of love has come, centering my soul. Amazing things abound, 'cause now we've reached our goal. So celebrate your liberation, shine your love throughout the world. Consciousness proceeds through being. I am here, I am now, I will light the way. Oh, love will lead us on. Oh, love will clear the way. Oh, love will show the world. Stories old, walk into the new, free to be at last. So stand up and be true, and celebrate your liberation. Shine your love throughout the world, 'cause consciousness proceeds through being. I am here, I am now, I will light the way.
Let's all twinkle Omashar and give him some happy Valentine's Day love and appreciation.
Thank you so much. You know what? Yes, it's interesting because I have not had a partner except for myself for a while. And so I'm learning a bit of self-love here, how to truly treat myself with respect and love and feel the love that I feel when I was with a partner. And so I'm looking forward to the rest of this evening, brother. Thank you.
You know, as you say that, Omashar, I just want to acknowledge that this could be a really tough night and time for people. People who are single, people that are recently single or long-term single, or even in a tough relationship that's going through hard stuff. It can be a tough night for people.
It's a real challenge because wherever you go, there's just Valentine's Day adverts everywhere. Buy 2,000 roses for $1 in this shop over here. And so I get it. And, you know, luckily I'm heart-centered. And so I don't really feel I'm missing out, but I do feel it. Yeah.
Well, thank you. I'm going to read a few comments from some of our audience members, and then we're going to get to the show. Eleanor Joy writes, I was about 25 years without a partner. Rather, my divine mother, nature, and higher self were and still are my partner. And that's true. But then we all have been watching Eleanor Joy as she has brought Ian into her life. I've got the camera on the two of you right now, by the way, Eleanor Joy. So after 25 years single, that's a beautiful story. And it's been kind of fun for us to watch that. Couple of other comments. Kiki writes, Happy Valentine's Day, Global Peace Tribe, Soul Tribe. Love, light, and blessings to all. Ayata writes, Hello, beautiful Global Peace Tribe. Joining you this rich and rain-blessed evening from traditional Ama Muslim homeland on glorious Monterey Bay, Santa Cruz. And yes, as Omashar says, love will lead us on. And welcome from Dom Drake, Susan Bloomquist, Adiara, Starwolf, and all of you who have started to write in the chat box. Welcome. All right, so I'm going to ask each of our guests to answer a question. And I'm asking them to do it in a very personal way. And hopefully it's something that we can all learn and grow together. And the question is simple. It's, what is a specific way that you are practicing greater love in your life? And that's the first question for all of our presenters. But I also would like to extend that question to our audience. I'll put it into the chat box. And for those of you who are watching on Facebook, you can try, come on into the Zoom room. I'll show you how to do that in a moment. Let's make this interactive. Again, what is a specific way that you are practicing greater love in your life? And I'm actually going to go to Ariel first because I just always love what she has to say.
Yay. thank you, Scott. You know, I've just really been reflecting on, I feel more love in my life than I perhaps feel like I ever have before. And I really want to name like the beauty of that, especially because I'm not in a romantic partnership right now. And I also feel love being reflected back to me in a way that feels like there's been an accumulatory buildup. And to your question, when I feel into what is one way that I'm practicing even more love in my life right now, one of the ways that stands out for me really deeply is prioritizing my creativity in a way that I don't ever feel like I've given myself permission to before. I really have been reflecting, especially after going through quite a challenging time this past fall, of the shoulds that I've placed on myself for a very long time around where I'm required to focus most of my life force energy. And so much of those shoulds have been, you need to focus the majority of your creative energy on things that create financial prosperity for you. And to focus it outside of that can be done once you reach this artificial idea of what security and safety is. Mm-hmm. And I got to a place of realizing, you know, like placing that pressure upon myself and giving myself a rule that I'm not allowed to focus on my creativity. And for me, that really shows up for my passion for music. I really realized that there is a way that I've been invalidating myself and my worth and my enoughness by constantly telling me that myself that I'm not allowed to focus on what brings me joy purely because it brings me joy until I reach some point out in the future. And I just realized how that's, it may sound like a strong statement, but actually an act of violence towards myself. So I've chosen to allow my creativity to take a front seat in my life, and realizing that it's actually deeply important for me to allow my creativity to take a front seat in my life, and that I'm not unique in that. I actually believe it's deeply important for every human being on this planet to prioritize their creativity, because to me, our creativity is source longing to express itself through us in a way that it can't in anyone else. And more than anything, especially with AI technology and everything coming out into the world, I genuinely believe that authentic human creative expression is one of the most important things that is needed on this planet. And it's also one of the most deeply self-loving acts that we can offer ourselves.
Beautiful opening thought. Tiara writes, yes, Ariel, creative people who don't have an outlet suffer. Thank you for speaking out about self-love as the antidote to self-neglect. Beautiful. And I noticed people were kind of going, yes, on some of the things you were saying. So I noticed Dia Therese at that point said that. So thank you. I'm going to read a couple of comments and then we'll go to our next presenter. Susan writes, in my life, small acts of self-love each day is a way to honor expression. That's beautiful. And Eleanor Joy writes, for me, it's making a conscious choice as much as possible out on the street with Ian, with my family and friends, and with myself and with my divine. All right, let's go to another one of our presenters. Let's go to Stephen and Nina. And I'd love for each of you to answer the question separately. And again, it's so what to have you with us.
Yeah, thank you, Scott. One of the ways that I'm practicing greater love in my life is the word permission comes up for me, not from like an authoritative posture of like permitting something to happen, but more in kind of like the spiritual kind of Zen acceptance and allowance kind of flavored use of the word. And like, particularly for myself right now, like I'm so sick right now. I think I might have COVID, and there's a part of me that was like, oh no, am I going to be centered and embodied and in my power and potency on tonight's call? Like I actually long to be, but I decided to just show up with this quality of just like giving myself permission to be where I'm at and like letting that be okay. And instead of being in sort of contentious opposition with it. And the same goes with how it's showing up in my love relationship, but also with my family and coworkers, et cetera, is like, there's this quality of just like letting people be where they're at without being in contentious opposition to it. And like wanting, being at odds with wanting something from any of those places and like the residual suffering that can come along with being in contention to where someone's at. And so just like practicing just a clean energy field permissiveness without any hooks, attachments, or longing. Longings are there, but without any hooks or attachments to them being a certain way, and just like letting that be okay.
That's beautiful. Thank you. Nina, how are you practicing greater love in your life?
Well, when I first heard that we were invited to be on this show and I was talking to Stephen about this, something that he's reflected to me many times that I do and hold and walk myself through very often is really communion and holding with my inner child and bringing so much love and compassion and patience to her. And I went through, I experienced a pretty deep shadow work period back in the fall in October and November. And my experience was that there were so many opportunities.
I think we've lost your volume.
Yeah, I couldn't tell if that was me or you, but about 30 seconds ago, your volume went out.
Still no, you're unmuted, but we can't hear you. Must have been exactly what we really needed to hear. That's why it does that.
And the winning lottery numbers are...
I know, right?
What was the last thing you heard?
Start again.
So what I began to share was a way that I bring greater love and practice greater love with myself, which then ripples out, is working with my inner child and holding space for her to experience. Just going to take a moment to gather myself after the interruption.
Yeah. And Stephen, move the microphone a little bit closer to her, please.
Are we in here now?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So what I was sharing is how when Stephen and I first were talking about this opportunity of being on here tonight, his reflection that he's mentioned to me many times was around the way that I've shared with him that I hold myself in my processes and specifically with my inner child. And it's so interesting, this dynamic between really allowing her to experience whatever she's feeling and have all of the feels and the emotional experience while also holding space for that dynamic and showing up in the divine parent is what I call it, this grounded, rooted, wise version of me who has all the compassion and all the empathy in the world and is patient in the same way that the mother is with a child. As you know, anything is coming up, allowing that to really be a safe place to feel that. And I was experiencing a pretty deep shadow process back in the fall where I had a lot of opportunities to hold myself and walk myself through that. And really the gold is always coming back to empathy and self-compassion and patience with myself and allowing that feeling process to take place. Has been a journey for me to bring that acceptance, that self-acceptance forth in my journey of love.
Yeah, this is so beautiful what you're sharing. It's the first time I'm getting to hear you speak. And inner child work is so important. And learning to get in touch with the different parts of ourself. One of the things that I do sometimes is I love baseball. And I have an imagining of my most exalted self, who lives in an alternate reality, is a great baseball player. And my inner child, who's a little boy, plays catch with my super Scott. Super Scott gets to play catch with Little Scott. For Little Scott, it's so cool. I'm playing catch and talking with Big Scott. You know what? Big Scott gets just as much out of it. And that dynamic has been really helpful to me making my way through challenging times and also kind of healing some of my inner child wounding. So anyway, I didn't mean to make it about myself, but you just got me excited to share that. And thank you. It is so important for us to give voice and love to all parts of self.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, next we get to go to our shamanic guest. Welcome back to the Awakening World, Star Wolf. It's wonderful to see you. And what would you like to share with the audience that you're doing to create more love in your life?
Well, I'm in love with love, and I always have been. Perhaps it's because I was born in 1952 and became a hippie in the 1960s, and it was peace, love, and Woodstock. And there's still a part of me that's still an old hippie or a young hippie, however you want to look at it. And, you know, I grew up in the age of all you need is love. And on one hand, that can feel like spiritual bypass. But when you've done as much shadow work and inner child work that I've done, that's not what's happening. It's the ultimate truth. And it's the reward of working with the light and the shadow, not only the light, but also the shadow. And knowing that the shadow, as many people have said, also has wings, you know, and it longs for love. As we just heard and we're just speaking about, a lot of our shadow, of course, is created mostly, I think, from our childhood. We come in with karma, we have things in the womb, but I think a big part of it happens in our actual world. But for me, on an everyday practice right now, and I'm very in love at, you know, at this time, you know, this is my mine and my husband's 9th anniversary of falling in love on February 14th. And so he said, "Are you sure you're going to do this night?" And I'm like, what better way than to share love than to do something like this on this day? So he's behind the scenes with music that we'll be playing in a little bit for the journey. So he's offering his love that way. And we've put the music together specifically for this group right before we came on. So it's a channeled piece of work that's evocative and then gentle and loving and takes us through something and out the other side. In my everyday life, or since the way we celebrated our anniversary today of love, is that we shepherd and are guardians of the land. I don't like to say we own it because it owns us, but 50 acres here in the top of the mountain in Western North Carolina, where I moved here 20 years ago from California. And we shepherd this land and care for it. We have elemental temples here. So we went to the elemental temples today, and our newest one is, we have a beautiful statue of Isis that's probably weighs about 700 pounds that we had created and put on top of the mountain. She'll be unveiled in April. And we put it on the top of the waterfall, and we just did some rituals and ceremonies over there. We took our two wolf dogs with us. We came back, he fixed the perfect dinner for us. And being close to nature, being with people that you really love and love you and that have your back, having a really good meal together that you've cooked and prepared together, and living every day in ceremony and in gratitude. We have a beautiful altar. We have altars all throughout our home. This is just my medicine room, but it's like this through the whole house. Which is quite interesting when anybody comes in to fix anything in our house, the repairman. But anyway, we have a beautiful altar in the living room that's dedicated specifically to our relationship. And each day we stand in front of it, light candles, and each of us can go to it individually or whatever to really nurture the love we have for ourselves, for each other, and the people that we serve with Venus Rising, which are thousands of people around the world. So I'm happy to be here tonight and to share this love. I have so much gratitude in my life. I'm 71 years young, and I appreciate every single day And, you know, I'll say one last thing, and that is one time I was talking to a Native elder grandmother, and she was in her 80s, and a Wolf Clan grandmother, and I said, you know, I was crying about something, and she looked at me, and she smiled, and I said, "What about you, Grandma?" She said, "Sweetheart, keep breathing. It gets better." Can't hear you, Scott.
Thank you so much for sharing that. And, you know, something that she spoke of that I wanted her to know is we're not going to do our traditional meditation at 6:30 p.m. as we normally do, because we're going to conclude tonight's show in about 1 hour from now with Star Wolf leading this beautiful breathwork journey into love. And thank you for creating music just for tonight. And I love the example that as a couple, part of your Valentine's night, instead of just going out to dinner, or you actually did a creative project together. And that's a beautiful thing. You know, creativity and creating together is really important. So as a love coach, I see that the couples that have things they share bigger than the relationship tend to be healthier couples. So that's a beautiful thing to share. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, our final presenter tonight is my good friend, Katrina Vaillancourt. And she is, of course, the creator of the Love Smart Card. She's a wonderful love coach, the co-founder of Love Coach Academy. Also has a wonderful partner, someone I love, named Stephen, her husband. So Stephen, if you're watching, thank you for blessing us with Katrina being on the show tonight. And Katrina, what do you want to share with the audience?
Yeah, thank you. There are so many wonderful tools that have been shared already. Really resonated with what Ariel said about creativity, finding that time to nurture in that way. What Stephen said about permission and acceptance as a way of relaxing whatever rough edges we might have just as we walk through life and meet different people and have different experiences. Those are really, really crucial. I also really loved what Nina said about working with the inner child, finding that way to give ourselves care where it wasn't there as we were growing up. And so I loved that piece. And of course, Star Wolf added a number of pieces, including the ritual with her partner. I heard, you know, the beautiful altars, the earthing, being in nature. And so, yes, I love all of these. And there are so many practices that I love, deep meditation, affirmations. And the one that's really been more like the cream on top most recently in my life is random acts of kindness. I love having like little ways that I just drop a little like, "Hey, I see you. I love you. You matter." You know, to people I know or people who are random strangers. Like random strangers can be really fun to just do something sweet. So, you know, one example of that, I flew down to LA this last weekend, had a wonderful time there at the Conscious Life Expo. And when I was on the plane, the woman next to me wanted to get both a tea and a ginger ale on the flight. And the person who gives out the drinks said, "You only get one drink." And so I said, "Oh, I don't need water. I'll get a ginger ale," because that way I was able to give her both of the drinks that she wanted. So that's one piece. There was another time I saw somebody who was just like working security, just sitting in a chair all day as people passed by. And so I started up a conversation. I said, "Would you like a 5-minute shoulder rub?" And that completely made his day. There's another woman who I met over the weekend at this expo who had, she was just curious about what was going on. And so I stopped and had this really sweet conversation with her about her life and her desire to attract love in her life. And because I'm a love coach and that's the work I do, I was able to support her with some gifts that are empowering her to move forward. And of course, that's a relationship that is blossoming and is going to continue. She was just very compelled by that and wanted more connection. So it's just such a beautiful opportunity to see where can we offer some kind of random act of kindness? Might be opening a door for someone. It might be, you know, paying for somebody's coffee at a coffee shop. It might be paying for the toll of the person behind you if you're going through a bridge toll. It might be as simple as a smile or a very authentic, like, hey, how are you doing today? And listening with a true sense of care. So that's the one that's rising up. I just notice how every time I do this, I feel so wonderful. And it's such a great way to cultivate and empower love.
Beautiful. Thank you. Eleanor Joy just wrote, Katrina is speaking my language. This is one of my gifts that I like to share, random acts of kindness.
Beautiful, Eleanor.
Yeah. I have an answer. This is one time that I want to share a little bit too, and it's radical acceptance. I'm in the change business. People come to, really all of the presenters you saw tonight, people come to us because they want to change something. They want to improve their relationship. They want more love in their life. And one of the things that I've learned is that radical acceptance is the foundation on which true change actually can take place. When our partner wants us to change or needs us to change, usually we don't feel supported. We go into reaction. And when I say partner, it could be a friend, it could be a parent, it could be a child, it could be anyone in your life that wants you to change. Now, most of us know what it's like when we want someone else to change. And we certainly know what it's like when somebody wants us to change. And change is good. Change is a good thing. We want to evolve. We want to grow. We want to change. But when there's that, you've got to change for me to be happy or for me to like you, we are probably going to go into reptile brain. We're probably going to go reactive and push it away. So the irony is that when someone can fully accept us, when we can fully accept ourselves, when we can fully accept another, it creates spaciousness. We feel loved. We feel that kind of unconditional love that we're all seeking, you know? And then from that place, I want to be better. How can I meet more of your needs? How can I meet more of my needs or meet more of my own values for myself? So radical acceptance. And I just invite, and I'm working on it. There's some relationships in my life that are requiring radical acceptance. And acceptance doesn't mean condoning hurtful behavior. It doesn't even mean liking it, just accepting. That's the way this person thinks. That's the way this person speaks. That's the way this person sees the world. So that's my little tip for the day. Sylvia, I think, was inspired by you, Katrina, and she writes, I was at a discount grocery Sunday with the cashier watching me choose what I could get. He checked out the items I was going to leave and handed me the bag saying, these are good groceries, you need them. Wow. Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you. Susan writes, I also love random acts of kindness. Being in the present moment and being of service feels so good. And Diara wrote, yes, Katrina, if people knew how good it feels to be kind, kindness would rule the day. You know, my mentor, who also is a mentor for Katrina, and for Stephen, for that matter, was Marshall Rosenberg. And Marshall, one of my favorite quotes, Marshall, is the greatest joy in life is being of service to others. The greatest joy in life is being of service to others. And I would like to add that the greatest tragedy in life is people who don't know that, people who haven't learned that yet. All right, we are going to go to Ariel. I'm not going to ask each person a personal question. Oh, you know what? Before I do that, if any of you have personal questions, pop them in the chat box right now, actually. And if you're like, God, I really want to ask Nina about this or Stephen about that, now is the time. And while you do that, I'm going to do a quick promotion for a Global Peace Tribe, because most of the people watching this show are watching us on Facebook or on one of our broadcast partners, and I want to invite you to join the Global Peace Tribe. It's really easy. Just go to globalpeacetribe.com. globalpeacetribe.com. You can learn all about who we are and what we do. And then click register for the new season. And that takes you to our registration page. We do two or three shows every week with wonderful co-hosts and interesting topics. All of our shows are inspirational and informational. We provide a meditation 7 nights a week. This is the show that you're watching right now tonight. And then this is the show we'll be doing on Saturday night. Our shows are always on Wednesdays and Saturday nights, and then we do special things in between. And on Saturday night, our show is going to be all about embracing the path forward into an awakening world. We've got some amazing luminaries who are going to be with us that night. So come and join right now. And that way you can jump into the Zoom room and you can ask questions of our presenters. And you'll find we've got a very beautiful Global Peace Tribe. It's a beautiful community forming. So please do join us. All right, let's see if any questions have come in from anybody. No, no questions yet. Don't be shy. I've got a question for Ariel. So I'm going to bring her up. So Ariel, how do you manage heartbreak? And I wanted to ask you that because I've read some of your beautiful writings in the past about heartbreak. You've been so vulnerable and honest. And so if you don't mind my asking that question, because I'm just guessing there might be some people tonight who might be dealing with some heartbreak.
Yeah. That's a beautiful question. There's probably going to be multiple pieces to it. The first piece that arises, it's the same answer that Stephen gave, but it's in a different context of permission to fully feel the heartbreak. I don't know about you, but especially earlier on in my journey, I used to judge the intensity of my emotions. I may not be the only person here who at some point in their life, they were told they were too sensitive, or their emotions were too much, or they're just being a drama queen. And, you know, what has truly been the greatest alchemist of heartbreak for me, which I don't experience heartbreak to be a bad thing. I experience, you know, to be human in is to have our heart broken in some capacity and to also have our heart broken open. And what's allowed me to move through heartbreak and glean the wisdom from it, and also allow myself to open into deeper love of life through it, has been the permission to let myself feel all the things. Now, this is different than acting on those feelings in ways without discernment. I'm not talking about, you know, taking anger or grief or resentment or these things that, you know, we can cause harm with these emotions if we give ourselves permission to act out on them in any way that we might want to in the moment. So not permission to act in any way we desire, but permission to let everything move through us and be felt. And especially for those of us on the spiritual path, at some point we can come up against this narrative that there are certain emotions that are just very unevolved. And if we experience any of those emotions, oh, I see all these like these glass balls on the screen right now. I don't know what's going on. There we go. We're back now. But you know, if anyone's been on the spiritual path, or at least, you know, perhaps the new age spiritual path, there can be this narrative of like, oh, I shouldn't be feeling anger. I shouldn't be feeling these denser emotions. And the judgment of the emotion, in my experience, is actually what creates repression in the body and can often, one, just lead to a shutting down of the emotional self, and resentment and, you know, perhaps unprocessed anger or grief and held in the body can actually lead to dis-ease on a physical level. So permission to feel the full range, regardless of what the emotions are. I could go on for a very long time for this. So I think the one other piece that I'm going to speak to, which feels integral, is forgiveness. Mm-hmm. Forgiveness of the self and forgiveness of the other. And not even because the other did anything wrong, even though we can tell the story that the other did something wrong, or even the self-judgment of how could I have put myself into that situation where that happened? How could I have not listened to myself, or how could I have done whatever that led to that? I'm visiting my mother on the East Coast right now. We went out for coffee earlier today, and I was telling her that I've gotten to the place where the most valuable thing in the world to me is my inner peace. And if I don't have peace in my heart and peace in my body and peace in my mind, nothing else matters. And I've a lot of my work and a lot of my personal practice is looking at where is fixation on things that exist outside of us or people that exist outside of us, co-opting our inner peace. I'm reflecting on, a challenge that I was moving through with a family member a couple of months ago. And more than anything, what I was present to was how much my desire for this situation, for the person to act different or be different and wanting to control it. What was most present to me was the amount of emotional and energetic drain that was creating for me in my life. And it was taking me out of the present moment. Like, our presence is the most valuable commodity on this planet. And resentment or regret or wishing something was other than it was, or fearing that we made a mistake and fixating on what we could have done differently to create a different result, it's like a hole in the bottom of our bucket. So practicing authentic forgiveness and, kind of pulling on the strand of what Star Wolf said, and I really appreciated Star Wolf's distinction of, we're not talking about the type of love that's spiritual bypassing, that we do get to a place when we've done enough shadow work and also know that we're just perpetually committed to the practice of shadow work, that living in love is one of the gifts of that. So similarly here, I'm not talking about the day after you experience the heartbreak, just say, I forgive myself, I forgive them, check mark, okay, we're complete, move on now. There's an arc to the moving through of the particular, any type of grief process, and particularly the heartbreak process, where we can't fake moving through all those emotions. So there's got to be a pacing to where the forgiveness is actually embodied and authentic. I moved through a really intense heartbreak process earlier this fall. And the beautiful thing is that I've moved through enough grief processes, not necessarily heartbreaks, but I've moved through enough of these processes where I know that if I'm really deep in the down, I know that there is immense beauty on the other side. And giving ourselves the grace to authentically move through the process so we don't need to create another scenario to learn the exact same lesson.
Well, Ariel, I think you can start recovering from being accused of too sensitive club with a number of people in the show tonight, or in our audience tonight. Several people have responded to that. Dia Therese writes, yikes, c'est moi. Admonished from being too sensitive, making mountains out of molehills because others do not smell, see, hear, sense what I do. I'm learning to pay it no mind and to trust myself and relax my 12 strands of DNA. That's beautiful. Mikhail was told, I was told I was too loud, too emotional, too big. Star Wolf says, I have often been called too much, and that has taught me to do the work to grow into that bigness in an integrated way. I recognize that my family and others may have been threatened because they were repressed themselves. So these are all beautiful comments about that. Ayata writes, I got so much of that as a child, too emotional, too sensitive, oftentimes as an adult also, but now I embrace the aspect of myself with gratitude. I also wanted to comment on one other thing that you touched on, Ariel, earlier when you're talking about the broken heart. You know, the best-selling poet in America for many, many years now has been Rumi, a 12th century Islamic gay mystic. It's the best-selling poet in America. Now, what's that all about? Why is that? And I think a lot of it is because of his wisdom of the pathway of the broken heart. And so much of what he writes about is because he had such heartbreak in his life and used that pathway of the broken heart to find God, to find the eternal beloved. So pathway of the broken heart is a very real pathway to highly spiritual advancement. Sure.
You're welcome. Thank you for the question. I'm grateful.
Well, we have a question for Nina. So Nina, I'm going to bring you up, and now we've got to go back and find it because we've gotten so many comments since then. So give me a moment. Here we go. This is from Diara. Nina, can you describe how you speak to your inner child, especially when there are adult tasks to be done and she doesn't want to do them or even know how to do them?
So this is something that I am very much still working on with myself and learning how to, especially when there's something that's like important to rise to the occasion and like the question asker said, when there's adult tasks to be done, that something that comes up for me is something that I learned from my teacher, Gemma Gonid, and it's around the inner child work that some of which I learned from her. She encourages talking to your inner child each day in the morning, part of like a little morning routine moment, and just taking a second to check in. And maybe you have a name for your inner child. I call mine little Nina. And I just tune in and I ask her how she's doing and if she needs anything. And I go in and out of practicing this regularly sometimes. And at this moment, I haven't been for a little while. And so it's a beautiful reminder, this question, to bring me back to that. When I was doing this very regularly, when I first started doing it, I noticed there was a lot of the time, there was more frustration for me not checking in more regularly. And as time went on, when I was doing it daily for quite some time, she started to become like, wow, you're noticing me. Oh, thank you for listening. Thank you for asking me. Like, I'm here all the time and you're acknowledging me. So there's just this like tender, open-hearted, sweet, innocent being that's within all of us. And we've all been that child when we were younger, and they're still with us now. And yeah, so taking that moment, that opportunity to engage with our inner children on a regular basis and asking them what they need helps, I feel, to get them kind of on our team for when there's things that maybe we may not want to do. Or from in my experience, I'm neurodivergent. So sometimes the executive functioning in my brain is, makes it challenging to like take action and do things in certain moments. And yeah, it's a constant journey of self-compassion and patience and extending that towards myself, towards my inner child, as well as if there's something that we may not know how to do, like that the viewer asked. I know sometimes for me, there can be moments of feeling like really confused and not knowing what step to take next. And for me, I have a really strong connection to God, to spirit. And sometimes it looks like when I remember to do this, it looks like opening up to receive the guidance from God of what is that next right action. Sometimes it's taking a moment to just like breathe, which actually I love to do with my beloved Stephen. We co-regulate so beautifully together where we'll breathe with each other and drop into presence into our bodies. And we'll even actually leave voice notes for each other on Signal of one of us breathing and the other. What I find when I listen to it, the voice notes from him breathing is I breathe along with it so we can co-regulate us at a distance, which leaves me what I was going to share next is sometimes it looks like when we don't know what step to take next, sometimes it looks like reaching out to another for support or guidance or space holding or even breathing and co-regulating together. I've been on this journey of learning that I don't have to do it all myself and I don't have to hold it all together myself. We're relational beings and we can be uplifted and supported by those around us when we allow that. And I know for me, I've been, oftentimes taking care of myself and being independent. And so I've been in this process of learning how to reach out and allow myself to be supported because I feel so, I turn it around. I think of what does it feel like when other people ask for my support? And I feel so honored. I feel so grateful to have the opportunity to support another. And so sometimes if I feel some like stickiness or edginess, like, oh, I don't want to be a burden. I don't want to over ask for this from someone. I remind myself, I do my best to remind myself that it's very likely that they'll feel honored and that if I ask and they have capacity, then I can allow that support. So yeah. Lots of different ways that we can support ourselves in moving through those moments of difficulty. And I would underscore it with being compassionate and patient with ourselves. And knowing we don't have to do it all ourselves, we can bring forth that support from spirit, from others, and also, tuning in to our inner children on a regular basis and allowing their voices to be heard can be a beautiful tool to deepen that relationship with them. And that's been my experience with little Nina.
It's beautiful getting to know big Nina. Yeah, thank you.
Something that I'd love to just quickly shoehorn in and remark is something I've seen her do over and over again. When she has a big to-do list to do, there can be moments where she can put really high expectations and pressure on herself to get things done. And if there's something like one, two or three things that are missed on the list, I've seen her be so kind and patient with herself. So I've seen this play out in real time.
Thank you.
Yeah. Like, she's excellent at being kind to herself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you for that modeling for us, Nina.
I can share a quick example. This is, we were hosting an event the other day together, and I was halfway to the venue and I realized that the rose petals, which was like a huge part of our decor for this couple's event, had been left in my fridge. And I previously to leaving had had a cacao explosion, like the cacao urn exploded on the street in front of my car. So it was a whole thing. So I was like driving to the venue and I was like, I forgot the rose petals because I forgot to double check the list because the cacao explosion like took me out, like distracted me. And so I let Stephen know, I was like, I'm going to go back now. I'll be late. We were already a little bit pressed for time for preparation. And I went and got the rose petals. So on my way back to my house and to the venue, the entire time it was just like, God is guiding me. Everything is perfectly on time. I am grounded. I am present. I am aligned. I'm speaking from source. Like it was just like this, rather than letting the mind go into spinning of like, oh my God, we don't have no time. We have to set up. There's a da-da-da. I'm going to be panicked for this event. It was just very consistent, grounded, calling on my high self, calling on the divine parent or that like inner voice of me that she didn't allow the inner child to panic. She was just very like, this is okay. We're going to be all right. Like wow. We got, yeah.
Beautiful. Beautiful. If you can give a quick answer, Susan wanted to know if you identify with a particular age or different ages in regards to your inner child.
Mm. So she shows up in different ages. I've had times where my inner teenager comes up. The one that I most relate to is this particular photo of me in this blue dress, short little blonde hair, blue eyes, like the specific, probably 4 or 5 year old version of me, because when I imagine her looking into her eyes or holding her in my arms, that's the version that I really relate to, but she's come forward in different ways. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Different ages.
Thank you so much, Nina. Well, while we've got Stephen, I actually had a question I was going to ask you, Stephen, but then a question came in from Drina Joy. So I'm going to tell you what my question was, and then I'm going to read hers, and we'll see if you can morph them together or just pick one.
Okay.
And I felt comfortable asking Stephen's question because he's one of the most emotional and intelligent human beings I've ever met. So the question I wanted to ask you, Stephen, was you're a relatively new relationship. Obviously, it's very important to you. And I'm curious how you're balancing moving forward with excitement and passion while also being a relationship coach and knowing how to look out for red flags and managing any veils of past pain that could be coming up in the relationship. You're dealing with that dance. So that was what I was going to ask. Well, Katrina, your question is also about balancing. Yes. How do you balance and explore different aspects of love, including tough love, quirky love, or naughty and funny love? So I don't know if you can try and tackle those together, if you want to pick one or the other.
Sounds like a fun challenge. Yeah. So the questions I tracked was red flags, like tracking red flags, as well as like evoking different layers of different flavors and expressions of love. That's kind of the bottom line. Is that right, Scott?
Yeah. In other words, as a relationship coach, you've got a view of what makes a relationship work or not work. As a human being, you've got your veils of past pain, but you're also in this incredibly exciting new relationship. How do you balance all of that?
Yeah. I'm gonna take on the veils of past pain first because I think it's the most poignant. Something that I've been really treasuring about my connection with Nina is all the different layers of synergy that are present. And something that's been really critical with that process and tracking to like to which degree there's rose-colored glasses on is taking moments to manage sobriety. You know, it's like a new relationship, it's a neurochemical extravaganza. And there's been certain check marks along the way where I've been authentically asking myself, like, how sober am I from that neurochemical frenzy? And if I feel like I'm not sober and I'm in this like tremendous love story about what's happening, like I allow myself to enjoy that while also acknowledging that there is an absence of sobriety. And so there's been moments in our exploration where we've taken a few days of space from each other. And I think those are really critical moments to really tune into self and just to make sure, just like check in for self-delusion. Like that has to happen in sobriety. And I think often when it comes to tracking red flags is that we can get into the rose-colored glasses space and pay less attention to things that don't feel so great because of how high we feel in the new relationship. And I think being able to be with both sobriety and the neurochemical extravaganza is really important. And touching on the veils of past pain piece, like that has been something that's come up for us. Like we have a beautiful relationship at so many levels, and it's been really hard at times too. And there's a really beautiful video on the Relationflix platform by Dolphin, who you mentioned earlier. And the title of the video is "How Do You Know If You're With the Right Partner?" And it's a very popular video on the platform. Not as popular as Ariel's content, but it's up there. And the bottom line of the video is the inquiry of, are we playing the same game together? And there's so many levels where I've seen us in tough moments, which are very sobering. And I keep finding us playing the same game together. You know, we're both bringing hurting tender parts into the relationship, and they get poked inevitably. And it's like, it's how we hold them that has been really, really clutch. And that's been playing the same game of help supporting each other to feel heard, accepted, felt, seen, and understood. And that happens through just tremendous empathy, which Nina is super relationally and emotionally intelligent and is just so incredible at. So I feel really met by her. And that was like a baseline for me in entering a new relationship. And it feels really great to know that I have that now. And kind of on the tone of choosing the right partner to relate with, something that I also treasure about our connection is that the alchemy of our connection in of itself gives way to all those different expressions of love. There's been times where we've been each other's cheerleaders. There's been times where we've been each other's sacred lovers, each other's sacred altars and places of temple and worship. There's been times where we've been super sassy and playful with each other, and there's just room for it all. And yeah, like she has a silly side, she's a great sense of humor, and she makes the most ridiculous faces at me sometimes. Like I've got photo upon photo of silly face photos, and yeah, there's just all these unique expressions, and there's room for all of them.
Beautiful. Thank you. You tackled that beautifully. Thank you so much. We're going to go to Star Wolf. And Star Wolf, as you've probably noticed, I'm asking personal questions because that's always most interesting. What I wanted to ask you about is I've noticed that you're in a beautiful long-term relationship with someone who's younger than you are. And I'm curious how that is for you. How is that? Have things come up that have been challenging? Are there differences that arise? And how do you manage that?
Yes, it can be challenging because sometimes I'm much younger than him. You know, you hear the cliche sometimes, especially when people are talking about being, you know, in May-December relationships of, you know, well, they're an old soul. And that can become very cliche. But it's very true for those of us who really truly believe that our souls are ageless and that they, you know, that they're ageless, but and they travel through time and space and have had many experiences. And, you know, we're actually getting ready to, you know, I've written 13 books, but the fourth one, and they've all been about shamanic consciousness, but the fourth, 14th book is really going to be about our relationship. And because it's a very big story, and of course, all love stories are very big stories, or we feel they are. But I've had so many people say, "You guys need to write your story." And in fact, I just spoke to a woman who used to work with CBS and MSNBC, and who writes for the Post, New York Post, and she said, "You know, you need to write this story because it's very moving." And it's challenging. It'll be challenging to others to read. But it also challenges us to open ourselves and to break open these self-inflicted boundaries that we put on ourselves sometimes of what's okay, what's not, those kind of things. And I'm not talking about healthy boundaries. I've been working in the mental health field and addictions field for 40 years. So I'm very much about safe boundaries and respectful. But back to your question of how do we deal with things? And, you know, I would say at first, not very well. You know, I mean, it was a bit uncomfortable. I kept telling myself that this was something that would pass quickly. My beloved husband before him had passed with cancer. My husband had been his mentor. So there was a lot of interweaving of our relationship. I met Nicholas when he was very young and he came here to our retreat center in the mountain. And as I said, Brad became his mentor. He went through our trainings, all these kinds of things. And then later on, he went out into the world and then he came back later. But when he came back, you know, when Brad was sick and dying at the end, and he was here actually when Brad passed, it was a very difficult time for me because up until, you know, what should I say? I really feel that Nicholas and I at this point are probably the best fit of any relationship I've ever had. But prior to that, my relationship with my husband of 14 years, Brad, was truly the best relationship I'd ever had. So I think I'm getting better, you know, not about anybody else, but I think that I'm getting better at relationship and relating in a very conscious way. But I was broken apart going through cancer with him for 2 years. And I think some of you know this journey yourselves. And it was a place of void for me. I wasn't looking for anything. I wasn't expecting anything. I mainly just kind of wanted to be in my own world of grief, creating my altars, being with spirits. And at that exact time, Nicholas came back through on his way. He was going to Thailand. He was going to go do some training out there with some body work and stuff and more breath work. And he stopped in really to be here for a while and just came in and he could see what a mess I was. I think I'd had the same gown on for a month. I wasn't exactly the most attractive looking thing at that point. And I was just broken down. I don't know that I'd ever been that low before in my life. And he just came in and he started tending to me, caring for me, supporting me. And eventually I found myself able to smile a little bit or even laugh or to watch a movie, you know, and have an interest in the world again. And people were very concerned about me and, you know, but I was just in my grief process. Tend to be a rather dramatic person anyway. But he didn't go to Thailand and he stayed here and he continued to be here and to befriend me, to be a anamkara, a soul friend. And we would just eat together. We would talk, we would laugh. I was sharing music with him from my era. He was sharing music from his era. And, you know, it would take so much because it's in 9 years now and, you know, of working through so many things together and keep coming back over and over and saying, have we completed this journey? And instead we said 4 years ago and 3 years ago, October 1st, we said, yes, we have completed this journey. We want to be married. So we went off to the beach during COVID, and we had Deva Pramal and Mitten came onto the screen and held space for us while we got married on the beach at sunset and sang our favorite song, which was that they had written called Inescapable Love. Because that's what really happened. You know, I bring tears to my eyes, but I really believe Brad loved him, my late husband, and he loved me. And what bigger love for him to call Nicholas energetically to come here, and as he did towards the end of his life, and said, please come back. And I think at some level, there was a soul contract that when Brad was finished, that Nicholas would come and would be with me. And part of that mystery is that Brad and Nicholas both share the same birthday of October 12th. And you can't make that up. That's just the way it is. There's much more synchronicities to it. But the biggest thing about love is to not be skeptical, is to not close down. Is that when our hearts break, to let them break wide open instead of contracting, to allow all the love in the world, make yourself available to it. To know that when it breaks open, like the Sufis say, it's breaking open so that it can grow wings and get even bigger. And I feel, you know, 9 years later, I feel so much better. I feel younger in my soul. I feel younger in my body. It's like, I can't even explain what's happened for me. I've had a huge shamanic death and rebirth and come out the other side. Since that time, I've written four more books. Our programs have spread all around the world. We're a global organization. We're an accredited shamanic breathwork programs around the world. We shepherd this land together. The expansiveness is so big sometimes. I really don't know how I can hold much more, you know, and I feel like it's holding me. So I know that's all over the place, but that's, you know, there's so much to share. That's why we're going to write it down and be more coherent. But I really encourage you to not close your heart to love. And whether that comes in the form of someone younger or someone older or someone, you know, same sex or, you know, someone that's a different color, someone that's even has maybe some different beliefs, you know, don't limit yourself to a prescribed way, because this is not, you know, I would not have written it down. They said, well, you know, write down what you want in a partner and all that. I didn't want a partner. I just wanted to go and join Brad on the other side. And instead, I believe I'm supposed to be here doing what I do best, and that is to bring shamanic breathwork to the world and to love people in a really big way, and to also be open to be loved just as much as I love others.
Beautiful.
So I'm going to stop it there because there's so much. And like I said, we'll write about it.
Yeah, thank you very much.
I see there was another October 12th birthday on here. So yeah, like Susan said.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Stormwolf. Thank you. Isn't it wonderful hearing people's stories? And, you know, I'm just learning so much about each of our presenters. And this is exactly the way I wanted the show to go tonight. So I'm very happy. Well, I'm going to bring up Katrina. And Katrina, the question that I've crafted for you is how to manage that balance of being in your own personal integrity and following your path while honoring the path of your partner. Katrina has a wonderful marriage. She's very committed to her partner. And they're quite different. They have very different backgrounds, extremely different backgrounds. And oftentimes different desires of how to spend an evening or a weekend. And so I know this is a dance you've been in. And so it's inevitable that in relationship, there are going to be differences. How do you manage balancing being true to yourself and honoring your partner?
Hmm.
Thank you. Big questions.
Good question.
Yeah, Stephen and I are very different. I have much more of a like new age hippie, Burning Man, ecstatic dance, let's all hug and cuddle kind of background. And my beloved husband, Stephen, was raised Catholic and did the whole corporate experience. He met his wife when he was 17. They were together 38 years, had 4 children. And so we have different social conditioning that just kind of appeared over time, because you don't know where things are different until you start rubbing up against each other. And we have been together for 8 years now, and have he actually found this quote that being in intimate relationship is like putting 2 rocks in your pocket and just walking around for a lifetime. And those rocks, they bump up against each other, and all of those hard edges over time, when you're really committed to staying together, soften. And so it really has been that kind of journey between us. There's been a lot of bumping up, especially in the early years. There were ways in which we thought we were speaking the same language, but we had different ways that we understood certain words. So that was a whole unraveling. And coming to this question that Scott brought up, which is such a great question, it's critical in any kind of deeply intimate relationship. How can I be true to myself and in integrity with my truth and love and honor him and be supportive of what's true for him? And the first key there is to deeply know yourself. I had a lot of time when I was single and dating between my first marriage, which ended in my early 20s, and this marriage. 17 years of exploration where I got to experience a lot of relationships. I got to really discover what I like, what I don't like. I had a lot of solo time to discover, you know, what makes me happy, what's important to me. And on top of that, I was blessed to discover nonviolent communication about 16 years ago. And actually, Scott was one of my first teachers. He's been a huge blessing in my life. The nonviolent communication practice is a way to deeply study yourself, to understand what your emotions are. And your emotions are always pointing to your underlying values. And so it comes down to a core level. It's not, I like the color purple, right? Because I know that about myself. And yet there's the deeper values. What's really important to me? I deeply value my family. I deeply value my relationship to my parents, my siblings, my son, and to my community. I deeply value my relationship with my former lovers. A lot of people in our world choose to end those relationships and then not have connection with former lovers. That has not worked for me. I mean, not that I'm connected to all of them, but there are some dear, dear beloved best friends of mine who I've dated in the past, and those relationships are important to me. So ecstatic dance, cuddling, like all kinds of things. Stephen, coming from a Catholic background, corporate, one woman background, has of course had challenges with my very open nature, wanting to deeply eye gaze, have these deep conversations, and to have more of physical intimacy, to have more of a sensual intimacy than anything that he had in his world. And of course, those were some of our rough edges together. So this is one example of many. Those were some of our rough edges. And we have had many iterations of conversations around how can he lean into accepting how important this is for me? And how can I lean into understanding how frightening it could be for him when I have those kinds of connections with former lovers or people who he considers maybe more attractive than him in some way or more talented in some way, right? If you look at the entire world, there's always going to be somebody who you find more attractive or better salsa dancer, or they're, you know, they're better at this or that. So he had chosen, he said, I choose you and I choose everything about you. I choose your past. I choose everything that has made you, you. I love you. And everything about you is what makes you who you are. And that was also my choice in being with Stephen is I love you and I understand that these things are scary for you. And let me see how I can be considerate in a way that creates more safety and security and communicates to our shared community that I'm with you, that I'm not available for other connections. Let's devise plans that really support that clarity of communication in the community. So there's a way that we just came to understand each other deeply. There's always layers too, deeply, so that we were able to come together and figure out, okay, how are we going to negotiate this upcoming event? Who's going to be there? What kind of challenges might happen? What is it you might want to do? If I get triggered, how are we going to handle that trigger? So we did a lot of negotiating in advance and then communicate about it afterwards. How did that go? What worked? What didn't work? And how do we adjust given the learning of this experience? So again, this is one example, and there's other ways. I generally love, you know, organic, more of a plant-based diet. He generally has been more of like your steak and potatoes kind of person. And so it's just been another place where we've used that same skill set. You know, let me deeply understand what motivates you around food. And we do that with each other. And then we look at, okay, so where can we come together? Scott, I'm just wondering if that feels like it brings clarity to that question, or if there's anything that might be missing that you might like to highlight.
Well, you know, I want to acknowledge that each question I've asked could be an entire show. And each of you have so much wisdom. So, you know, these are little homeopathic dosages.
True.
You know, for me, what I got most out of it was just really experiencing your profound love for Stephen, your understanding of his experience, while also not sacrificing yourself in the process and recognizing
there have been some sacrifices from time to time, but those sacrifices are calculated and they're temporary in nature. I don't make long-term promises that I know I can't keep.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a good
but one. I'll make short-term promises to create safety and security for a period of time so that he's been able to adjust. And he's similarly done something like that for me. And we've come into such an amazingly sweet flow. Mm-hmm. It's, I mean, you've seen our evolution, Scott. You've seen all of it. And it's just, there's so many times I'm pinching myself with the transformation we've been able to go through by, again, really seeking to deeply understand each other.
Yeah, and I want to acknowledge Stephen because it hasn't been easy, you know, to adjust to, you know, given where he's coming from. And his level of devotion to you, his level of flexibility and learning to be flexible has been beautiful to watch.
Truly, truly. It's awe-inspiring to me to see that level of devotion and commitment to being in an evolutionary relationship, a true sacred partnership.
All right, well, here's what we're going to do, because, gosh, this time is flying by. We're going to go to Omashar in a moment for a song. And during that time, I need for each of my presenters to put into the chat box whatever URL you'd like for me to spotlight. And then after Omashar's song, we'll do one more quick round with each of our presenters, learning how you can get more of Stephen and Nina and Ariel and Starwolf and Katrina. And then after we do that, Starwolf is going to lead us on a beautiful breathwork journey where we can all dive deeper into love. So that's what we're going to do. I'm going to go to beloved brother Omashar. Omashar, I'm going to ask you the question. What are you doing to create more love in your life? Besides the amazing music you provide for Awakening World, Unity Earth, so many other places now that have discovered your talents.
Yes, it's a complete trip because I was a wall-to-wall relationship person until I wasn't, and meaning back-to-back, and I used to have a sell-by date of about 18 months until I had children, and then I extended it a little bit. But I am absolutely in awe at the presenters tonight, and especially Katrina's last sharing. What dedication, how amazing. I wish I'd have known all of this when I was born. And I have what I have done through my serial monogamy is managed to completely repress until it was so repressed I didn't even know I was repressed. And it's through non-NVC and other people's work and their boldness and the sharings on formats like this that I've realized there is actually hope for my heart. And because it's been now almost 8 years since I've had an intimate relationship. And so I have felt a lacking there. But what Ariel was saying about creativity, that is where I get my deepest love, when I'm focused on myself and focused on what I truly love. And I've got over my procrastination, and I stick my heart and mind, let's say, into writing music. And I feel so much love because I only write about love and connection. And so that is the place that I have with me. And I have children around me at the moment too. And I'm learning to love the children, but also be very aware of how they're being programmed and watching my programming as their parents programmed them, and realizing that I was put in a box from the moment I left the womb. Holy smoke. I'm amazed at how I've emerged today. And so I think I'm going to stop there. I don't know if I answered any questions whatsoever. I don't really care. But we're sharing, we're open, we're free. And I know that the layers of pain that I have gone through have made me into what I am today. And I also know that my heart has been broken open so many times because I kept on closing it again. And now the last one that blew my heart off, I decided just to take the pins out of the hinges and leave it there, because I just want an open heart, no matter how it feels. And it's okay to feel. It's okay to feel. There it is. I'm going to sing. Here we go.
Thank you.
Just put on something backdroppy and some water. Precious one,
I love you more than I can say. You are the one that's here in my life all the time, shining your light through my day. Only you can take all of my troubles and cares. With your breath, you blow them away.
Good timing, beautiful.
A bit of a false ending there. I on a show like this, I get stirred, shaken, and on every single level. And my heart is alive, and my mind is ripe. And thank you.
Oh, thank you. And hey, reminder everybody, we can get Omashar's music on Bandcamp if you go to omashar.bandcamp.com. That's where they are waiting for us, those wonderful albums. And I've clicked follow before. I'll go there later on. Anyway, let's all participate. Let's all follow him. Oh my gosh, you're gonna make me choose. I just want to follow the guy.
I know, it's all right. You gotta press the motorcycle.
I got the motorcycles, all right.
I think has Starwolf jumped off.
What's that?
I think Starwolf has lost her connection.
Oh, well.
Oh no, there she is. She's back again. Yay.
I went off, but it came back.
It's all good. So yes, buy my albums. Thank you.
There they are. Bandcamp. Wonderful. That's the place to do it. Go there now. Okay. And Omashar will be back. Hey, a reminder that on Saturday night, Omashar and I will be back here doing a wonderful show. And we've got some really fascinating people. These are all part of the kind of Unity Earth Evolutionary Leaders Network tribe, if you will. And we're going to really be going into some beautiful practices for how to really awaken. And then wonderful Maggie will be doing our KES group healing. So join us, and hallelujah, Anasuya will be with us, and she always brings so much love. So make sure you're with us on Saturday night. Okay, I want to give each of our presenters an opportunity to share a little bit about how we can get much more of them. Tonight's show is gonna go a little bit longer, folks. We're probably gonna go till, I'm guessing, 8:15 or so. And we're going to go to Ariel first. Did you know Ariel, by the way, that my mother's name was Ariel? She spelled, she spelled it differently. She didn't have the L-E at the end, but she always liked to be called Mom Ariel. So
I love that.
Little moment there.
It's a powerful name.
It is. And now, do you relate to the Shakespeare Ariel? Is that kind of what your family had in mind, or?
No, I'm of Jewish heritage. So in Hebrew, Ariel means lion of God and messenger of God.
Oh, I didn't know that. I should have known. And that's interesting that it means messenger of God, because my wife was named Gabrielle, which is also messenger of God.
Mm-hmm.
So that's that, just personally, that's interesting to put those two together. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thanks for asking.
Well, I am going to your website, and it's her name. So it's A-R-I-E-L-L-E, ArielBrown.com. And you've got an amazing program that starts tomorrow. Tell us the desire.
Yeah, so it's called Holy Desire. This is the second round I'll be running. And really, it's a 12-week program for men and women learning to skillfully navigate truth, sexuality, and desire in intimate relationship and community. And really, this program birthed through with this idea, you know, of holy desire being this deep longing within us for love, for intimacy, for union, and also to discover why we're here. And I've also found that over the decade of working with people around desire is often we don't fully trust our desire, perhaps because we've made decisions in the past around saying yes to certain experiences or certain people where there's been pain, there's been heartbreak, or perhaps it's taken us down a dark path. And my view is that desire in its purest form is actually our soul guiding us towards our destiny. So Holy Desire is really a curriculum for learning how to ground deeply into who we truly are and what our inner discernment is, so we can actually move towards what we desire in life and love while deeply honoring our integrity and what we value in the world.
Beautiful.
And it begins tomorrow. So if you are interested, I invite you to check out the link and see if it's something you'd like to join us in.
If someone is interested, is there time for them to have a conversation with you before tomorrow?
Yeah. If you look at it, I'm on East Coast time, so I'll probably be heading to bed within the next hour. But if you check it out within the next hour, I'm going to post my Facebook, because messaging me on Facebook is probably the quickest way to get a response. Or you can email me at ariel@arielbrown.com. And the first call is tomorrow at 12 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. So I can definitely create some space tomorrow morning to have a conversation. And I'll put my email in here as well. And I'd be happy to chat and hop on a brief call to see if it's an aligned fit. We currently have 15 people registered. There's 7 women and 8 men. And this is like, I'm celebrating that, like, this is my first container where there's actually more men in the space than women, which is, it's a miraculous thing in the spiritual and personal growth industry. And they're just really beautiful souls.
That is pretty amazing. That's incredible. Wow. Ariel, thank you so much for being with us tonight. Thank you. And best of luck. It's going to be a great workshop.
I feel it. Thank you again for inviting me, Scott. Just really appreciate you and your devotion to creating this type of space in the world, like, so consistently.
My pleasure. My pleasure. Thank you. I want to mention, by the way, last week I brought on very spontaneously Mary Duncan, who talked about this workshop with the Koji people. And my understanding is 4 of you have signed up for this 10-day program. 4 Global Peace Drivers all signed up for it. So I'm really happy. It makes me happy to see that happening. So I really do enjoy bringing our presenters together with you, our beautiful Global Peace Tribe. Now, Ariel is part of something that Steve Rowland created. And again, some of you who are old timers, you know all about it, but for those of you who don't, Relationflix is the most amazing platform for anything on relationships. Stephen has pulled together, I don't know, what, 40 now? I think 35 or 40 amazing teachers, including Ariel. And many of you, of course, know and love Trish, and several other amazing educators and created Relationflix. So this is the place to go for all your relationship issues. And it's a beautiful website with videos and courses. So that's my lead in, Stephen. And what
thank you, Scott. Can you go to the top menu header and just click the videos button in the main menu there?
Sure can. Yeah.
So it'll show a little bit of the array of content that we have here. Hey, check that out. It's Ariel Brown and Scott and me in the first row.
I love seeing that. Hey, we got pretty good billing there.
Yeah. And it's just poetry because it's actually sorted by most popular. And I was just going to bring up how Ariel, since Relationflix's inception, which is precisely 2 years ago, we opened on Valentine's Day 2022, she's held the throne of most watched video on the platform. So serious kudos and tip of the hat to you, Ariel. And Scott, a couple of your videos have been chomping at the heels there too. So it's just really cool to see two people on this call who've we've shot amazing content with, and yeah, the platform itself is just an absolute treasure trove of amazing world-class relationship education, conflict resolution, attachment theory, compassionate communication, NVC, trauma recovery, shadow work, men's work, sexuality. It's just a super, super rich resource. And we are just on the cusp of launching Relationflix 2.0, which will include a slightly elevated brand look and feel, a lowered price point, as well as the inclusion of live broadcast, live coaching sessions for our subscribers. So yeah, it's a beautiful platform. Hope you check it out.
Highly recommend it. I did not know that those were the most popular ones, and I have a competitive streak, so I'm really happy. And if somebody has to be number one, I'm glad that it's Ariel. And Nina, is there anything you would like to let our audience know about that you're offering?
I mostly do in-person events right now, but we have some, we're bringing conversation about bringing some of our offerings to an online format. That we just did an event last weekend called Depths. What was the full tagline?
A conscious relationship experience for lovers.
And so we've actually been in conversation about bringing that into an online format for an 8-week course for couples, a program for couples. And we're actually going to be changing the name to Temple of Devotion. And we're looking to launch it in the fall. So that's exciting. And I will also be bringing some of my offerings that I currently share online in person on my own into more of an online format in the next couple of months as well, such as ecstatic dance and cacao ceremonies. So I'll drop my Instagram and yeah, here it is. And you can follow along and stay tuned for more upcoming projects that we'll be sharing together and mine individually as well.
Beautiful. It's been such a pleasure to meet you. You know, before we went on air, I thanked you, but it's just beautiful to see Stephen with such a really beautiful being inside and out. And one of the things as a coach that I always look at is how do people look at each other? The way you've looked at Stephen tonight has been so beautiful because I love him so much. So to see you looking at him the way that you do is like.
Thank you so much for having me and for that beautiful reflection. It's been such an honor to meet you for the first time. Mentioned before, I've heard just absolutely stunning things about you. So it's really a blessing to be here. Thank you.
Look forward to many, many connections online and hopefully in person in the future.
Absolutely. Blessings.
All right. So I'm going to go to you last, because you're going to lead the breathwork ceremony. So I'm going to go to Katrina next. If I can find her, where are you hiding? There she is.
Right here.
Well, Katrina has created these amazing love smart cards. We all have them. Wherever I go, there are the love smart cards on just about the shelves of all of my closest friends. And of course, I'll go to your website. But before I go to the website, tell people a little bit about the Love Smart cards.
Sure. The Love Smart cards are a surprisingly powerful tool that support people to understand and immediately apply the basic skills of nonviolent communication, as well as some of the skills of positive psychology. So this includes empathy, gratitude, character development, and conflict resolution. When I had shared earlier about what it took for Stephen and I to build a bridge that makes the deep, sweet love that we now have possible, these are the skills, right? Empathy. Empathy is a cornerstone to any kind of compassionate communication or any kind of bridge building between yourself and another person. And so this tool will help you learn and master the art of empathy from the convenience of your home on your own schedule. And so I have a bunch of practices and worksheets that go with that, that I send to you when you buy the Love Smart cards. Gratitude, of course, is what can help you to be more resilient, to choose to stay connected, even when you feel like you might be going crazy around another person, right? Because sometimes we can get so frustrated, we actually can lose sight of the love and why we want to be dedicated to the repair work. And character cultivation is an aspect of positive psychology that basically says that in life, we're going to have all kinds of challenges, and all of those challenges also provide opportunities to become the next best version of ourselves. So the character strength cultivation will support your awareness around being more patient, loving, forgiving, tactful, assertive, playful, prayerful, you know, all of these ways of being that will absolutely up-level your life. So those are the primary teachings that are in the box. And I have heard from so many of my clients that using these cards has literally worked miracles in their lives. I've had a number of clients who have said, we wouldn't have stayed together without the cards. So powerful tool. I highly recommend it, of course. And I've also included in the chat a discount code. So love 15 off will work in the checkout. So you don't get it until you put the Love Smart cards in the basket and you go to the checkout. Then you'll see the little box to put in your coupon code. If you choose to buy it, I look forward to supporting you. I also have some free online workshops you can find through my website. You'll find that on the top bar. Go to coaching, find out about me. And then below that is you can get a liberating love strategy session with me. You can see the free introductory workshops or courses link just above the testimonials. My monthly newsletter is down there at the bottom. That's just Calendly, right? That's to see what's available. So yeah, if you close this page, Scott, there's also a workshop page, and I have a couple free workshops that I offer on a monthly basis as a way of just gifting this in the community. It works with the Love Smart cards, highly recommended, but it can also work with words lists, which I provide during those Zoom workshops. So yes, those first two are free courses. Learn More and Register will give you the dates and times for those courses. And then the one at the bottom is my 8-week course starting in April. And this is a deep dive into learning the basics of nonviolent communication and then applying that to the very difficult conversations that can happen in intimate relationship, with an emphasis on handling the challenging topics of sex, money, and power. So if there's other things that people in the course bring to the course, we will certainly address it all. And I like to go into those difficult places and support you there, because I know that's what will make the biggest difference. So thank you, Scott, for sharing the website with everyone. And I would look forward to seeing any of you in an upcoming workshop or in a Liberating Love strategy session.
Thank you, Katrina. Beautiful work. Really beautiful. And Katrina is a wonderful, wonderful coach. You know, one thing I also want to mention, the Love Spark cards are great for children and teenagers, people of all ages. Great for parents, increasing their communication with children. I have a client that I work with in Australia, Krishna, who Katrina knows, and he just laughed at it and said, Scott, we've got to get my kids on the Love Smart cards. So they are quite wonderful. All right. Well, our last presenter tonight is going to lead us on an amazing journey in a moment. But before she does that, Starwolf, I'd love for you to share with people a little bit about your work. And her organization is called Venus Rising. And for those of you on Facebook, you can find it at shamanicbreathwork.org. Shamanicbreathwork.org. And is there anything you'd like to emphasize for our audience to be aware of that you're providing?
We have an online program, and we never did breathwork online until 2020. Didn't know if we actually could, but we did. And we actually did more breathwork with more people from 2020 to 2022, probably than we'd ever done in a year or two before, because everybody, we had a captive audience, you know, but we found out that it did work. I still prefer the real thing, you know, of in person. And we actually have met many of the people now that we did that online with. But we do have the 2 week coming up, and that will start, the training will start on the 17th and goes into March. And so it's on East Coast time. It's 4 hours. It's a big commitment. So I'll just put that out there. It's 7 to 11 every night for 14 nights. It is not recorded. It is shamanic initiation. It's shamanic breathwork integration. We have breakout groups. Right now, I think we have about 30 people signed up to be on from all around the world. That's a big commitment. But it's also the first level of our training. If you're not willing to go through the deep healing, then we're not willing to train you. So the healing is the training, and the training is the healing. And of course, healing is ongoing. It's not just at this point. But we want to know that people have done shadow work and inner child work and sacred marriage work and sacred purpose work before they go out into the world and start breathing people and taking them into altered states. So that's really important, especially right now when everybody is doing altered states work, to remember that there's a big, big piece of inner child shadow and integration work that needs to happen when we're taking people into these deep states of consciousness. So it's led in a shamanic fashion. There's many other opportunities, but that's the first one that's coming up. We train all year round. We have a 2 week long here in the summer in the mountain at our elemental temples. We'll be in Costa Rica, we'll be in Egypt, several places. We do some things online too. I do lots of interviews and programs where I'll give people, like we're doing tonight, just like a piece of a breath work. The breath work sessions are generally just the breathing itself are an hour long at least. And then afterwards you go into art and process groups. We won't be doing any of that tonight, but we will be doing an important piece of work for about 15 minutes because I know that we don't have that much time. So I shortened it down a little bit, but during that 15 minutes, you'll have an opportunity to move through the whole chakra system, and the music will be activating for you. It's meant to be activating, okay? And to activate your emotions, your feelings, your shadow, your inner child, all that sort of thing. And then it activates the heart. Mm. And it opens the heart, and then it activates the higher chakras to take us out into that expansive place where we can see the bigger story and then bring us back to love. So that's the hero's or heroine's journey, or the shaman's journey, however you want to put it, the lover's journey, lover's rock. And I think it's, you know, a beautiful way to come together this evening. Scott, before we, I may not get a chance to say this to you later on, I just want to say to you that I'm a big fan of yours. And I have witnessed and heard from so many people I know who know you, and it's all good stuff. And just how loving you are and how you consistently are an Aquarian being, bringing people together. You know, I like to fancy that I'm kind of the female version of you, you know, and but seriously, Scott, I just want to acknowledge you. Thank you for having me here. Thank you for all of your beautiful guests. I've learned a lot from everybody tonight, and had some beautiful comments and private messages, and it's been a beautiful way to spend Valentine's.
I'll bring our presenters up one last time so that we can see them. And yeah, what a beautiful group. And you know what? I forgot to take the class photo today. So everybody smile real quickly because I forgot to take our class photo. And it will also now have, oh, hang on, we gotta move. Yeah, there we go. All right, 1, 2, 3. Great. Usually we do that during the presenters meeting. And you know what? There's one other really important thing before we go into Star Wolf's breathwork. Eleanor Joy and her GoFundMe. You know, Eleanor Joy is who got everything started with the dancing to Omashar's music. And we love Eleanor Joy. She's going in for a big surgery. She's not going to be able to work. And I'd really like to ask if people haven't donated yet, please do donate to Eleanor Joy. She's a little over halfway through her goal. We need to raise $6,000 for her. So let's do that right now. I've put the, or I'm going to put in the chat box the link. There it is. And yeah, we want to definitely support her. And I see some of our wonderful friends, Carol and Susan, you know, are some of the people right there at the very beginning. Morgan, she's a global peace driver. So, and that guy, Anonymous, he just is beautiful with how generous he is. He's always supporting. I also want to acknowledge that we raised a lot of money for Beloved Piper, and still keep her in your thoughts and your prayers. She's in the midst of quite the journey. And I want to acknowledge Deborah Juliet, who is doing some really beautiful healing work with her. So thank you, Deborah, for the time you're donating to support our Beloved Piper. And Piper sends her love and appreciation to her Global Peace Tribe family. All right, I think I've completed my essential announcements, and I'm going to turn it back over to Star Wolf to lead us on a beautiful journey.
Also, somewhere in the chat, I can't see it on mine right now, but there is a gift there for you all this evening. And it's called The Spiral Journey. And it's a breathwork journey that you can do on your own.
I'll go through it. I'll find it.
If you can find that and put that, I don't know where it is now. There's been so much we've been chatting here. But it's on the side there. And so if you can have that as a gift.
Thank you so much. Thank you for your generosity. I will find it and repost it.
So I want to invite everybody, you can lie down, you can you know, turn your screen off, you can leave it on, you can do what you want to do. I encourage you to you know, have your speaker turned up so you can hear the music. The music is meant to be activating. I'm right here and I'll be keeping my eyes open and watching your chat. And if there's anything that comes up for you that you feel a little uneasy about or a little uncomfortable with, just let me know. And I'm right here and I'll be watching and holding that space for you. But this is a ceremony. It's not just a breathwork session. It is a shamanic breathwork ceremony. And I've been doing this work for 42 years. So I'm happy to hold this space with you all this evening. So make yourself comfortable. You might want to turn your lights down. And it's, you know, I know we have some lovebirds on here. You can hold hands if you want to while you're breathing. And if you'd rather be in your own individual space, you can do that. Okay. All right. So if we could begin, I'm just going to do the drum just a little bit because sometimes it doesn't come across as clear as it does here. And invite you to close your eyes. And you're just going to take a normal breath at this moment, a nice big deep breath and exhale. And I encourage you with your screen, you know, the sound turned off, you can make any kind of sound you want to make, a moan, a groan, a tone, a prayer, a chant, anything that wants to come out. Express yourself, as Madonna would say, express yourself.
Sorry to jump in. Scott, can I get sharing capabilities for music, please?
It's okay, you can do it now.
So I want to invite each one of you to encircle yourself with a golden light. The light of the sun, and to know that nothing can come in to harm you while you're in this open-hearted, vulnerable place. And that the music will begin to play in just a moment, that it's activating each of the chakras. Each piece of music will be a little different, and it will take you perhaps to your childhood, perhaps to your shadows, perhaps into the light, but it will not take you any place that your soul is not ready and willing to go to. You may cry, you may laugh, you may do both. You may feel a wide range of emotions, and that's what emotions are there for. But I pray for all of us tonight, this afternoon, evening, wherever you are, that the biggest thing is that we'll open our hearts to more healing and transformation and receive the messages of our soul's journey as spirit guides and helpers. And take a moment now to call in whatever's sacred to you. And that can be anything. You perhaps have a power animal, ancestors, elemental energies, deities, great spirit, whatever it is for you. And with your protection now, you can begin to breathe in just a moment. And remember that if anything comes up and you need to reach out, I'm watching the screen here with you. Begin to do the breathing, breathing in, breathing out. Breathing in. Breathing out. Connected breathing. And the music begins to lead us to more love. Let your body move if you want to move your body.
Dance. your body dances, your soul will travel. Body dances, your soul will travel. While your body dances, your soul will travel.
Breathing. Let some sound out. Breathe.
Opening the heart, breathing, surrendering into love. Really open yourself to the divine love.
Take a deep breath and exhale fully. And slowly begin to return, gathering up all the love that you have for yourself and others. And just to bring us back and ground us now, remember that it's okay to fall in love. It's the best way to fall. And I've asked Nicholas to play a song to ground us and help bring us back. And I can't think of anybody better than Elvis.
Wise men say, only fools rush in, but I can't help falling in love with you. Shall I stay? Would it be if I can't help falling in love with you? Like a river flows surely to the sea, darling, so it goes. Some things are meant to be.
Delight. Thank you so much, Star Wolf. And thank you, Elvis, for that was really, really, really fun. What a beautiful, beautiful experience. And a reminder, everybody, that Star Wolf is someone who provides beautiful experiences. And she's got this training starting this week. So thank you, everyone. I know that we went late tonight, but it was worth it. A beautiful, beautiful show. And let's all practice radical acceptance and all the other tools we learned tonight. And remember to share the Global Peace Tribe out with your friends. Tonight's a perfect show. Take the recording and share it with your friends. I'm going to put into the chat box right now. Here it is. This is the recording of tonight's show, which I actually just sent to Stephen and Nina. But there's the link for tonight's show. Share it with your friends. Let's build our audience. Let's build our tribe. Take care, everybody. I look forward to seeing you on Saturday night. And I'm going to go to gallery view one last time for all of you that are with us. Take care, and may love bloom in all of our lives in wonderful ways. Good night, everybody. Thank you, George.